Good morning, everyone, and such a fantastic day. Thank you all for being here for this valedictory section, which closes the end of the senior executives program. Before we begin and invite a very honored guest for his speech, I'd like to make a couple of announcements and more a very heartfelt apology from NIAS for the discomfort and inconvenience that was caused to all of you yesterday. I'm really very sorry about it. It's the first time in the history of NIAS it's happened, but that doesn't excuse it. And may I also thank all of you for rising to the occasion with graciousness and patience. Thank you all very much once again. I'm very sure, I mean, I was there, so I know about the discomfort it caused you. Thank you all for your accommodation once again. One small announcement. Some of you have not given your feedback forms in yet. May I request you all to give it in before the end of the function and the end of the day? Thank you all. And now I would like to invite our director, Professor Baldev Raj, to welcome our distinguished guests and to initiate the proceedings. Thank you once again.
Good morning to all of you, and thank you, Professor Sindhu Radhakrishnan. My gratitude and love for Mr. Senapati Chris Gopalakrishnan, who has agreed to come and give the valedictory address. At the valedictory address, during our discussions, we were thinking of a person who has experienced industry, who has been a thought leader, who has deep interest in education and contributed to education. Also, a person who knows what are the frontiers of the research. For one person, it is very difficult, but all of us as human beings, we stretch ourselves, our imagination and bodies to be able to find our space. Chris Gopalakrishnan stands very tall among the citizens of India and Asia and the world, which is well demonstrated by his achievements. So we are really delighted you are here. I am also thankful to dear Karthikeyan, who has fell in love with all of you and through you with NIAS. He goes out and then comes back whenever and as early as he can. Thank you very much, Mr. Karthikeyan, for being with us. When you came on Monday morning for the first session, I did mention about the beauty of the NIAS, and I also wish that you would explore the beauty of NIAS and walk through the woods to refresh yourself. At that time I mentioned that NIAS is a place where G.R.D. Tata imagined and taught the leaders at that time that the natural sciences, social sciences, technology have a space to discuss if really the nation wants to be a nation where equity would be important and we would become one among the best. It's not difficult to imagine, as you have seen from most of the discussions over last 4 days and today on the fifth day, that there are more differences than agreements. And my experience in NIAS has been that I get a little concerned when the agreement comes too often. I think when you combine these disciplines across, you find that there have to be even the differences in the vocabularies, the cultures of the professions, but that is a strength. That is not a weakness. And the leader, especially a leader, must be able to reconcile all that, not only reconcile that, in those noisy, scattered patterns, sometimes you must be able to find a direction. And if you are not able to find a direction, you must have a patience to go along till your deep learning is completed on that subject. So NIAS is all about that. I also mentioned, I come back to what I said in the first one and what I've been experiencing along with you, because I've been also a participant along with you in most of the lectures which you have given, that the biggest dividend in this country would come by gender participation. And India is a country where If you look at our psyche, if you look at our civilization, it should be much easier than many other countries, but we lack in this very much. So we had three wonderful ladies. I could see how they have participated in various things. I believe you would be able to convince more wonderful ladies to come for the next course, and I'd be delighted if we have near 50-50 participation, or I would be more delighted if there are more ladies as compared to men in this thing, because I sincerely believe from my family upbringing or bringing in atomic energy that how the ladies bring balance and new perspectives, and they are, pardon me, arguably, they are much more human than the men folk. I think it is being a mother, being a sister, being a colleague is what teaches them. So I'd be really delighted if you become our spokespersons and bring more ladies, and really the ladies who would lead this country. It is again very important that you heard many leaders, and they were all very accomplished in their own way. And you have your own leadership qualities, and you would find certain things which don't resonate with you and certain things which resonate with you. And ultimately it is your critical thinking which would make you feel that how experience it has been relevant. So I would not be surprised that if it is just an experience and doesn't really have any profound effect on you, but it gives you a framework in which you think and see the experiences of the other, because for a good leader, she can learn, but it is not necessary that the good leader absorbs everything whatever she or he sees around that. From the discussions which have happened, I am very clear that it is going to be the way how it is there. Your feedbacks are important for us to enrich, because today it is the 30th course. That means about 700 participants have already experienced this interactions, and about 400 leaders have come and talked to these speakers. So it's a family of about 1100 people, and we do many flagship programs. We have about 6-7 programs in a year. So we are a family of about 7000 people, and 7000 people, if we consider as the alumni, they are a very strong force looking at the quality of the people with whom we deal to make a change. So I'd like you to be a cohesive force, and we are available to you, and if you make yourself available to us, we'd like to work with you on the problems which we work, like inequalities. And I have been really studying hard to find, was there any period in the civilization where there was equality? Inequality is something which we have talked in abundance, but very rarely been able to really challenge the inequality. So this one of a deep domain of study in NAS. We work on education, again, education of gifted children, education of deprived children. And again, it's a very, very fascinating subject, but very difficult to make the impact. Easy to make oration, but difficult to make the impact. But those are the areas which we work. The consciousness, which we believe Chris Gopalakrishnan is very deeply interested in studies of the brain. He has been personally interested. He has enabled many groups to do that. But we believe that the brain and consciousness, the unknown part, unknown because we don't know, otherwise it is a known part, which even yogis like Patanjali and later on so many have been able to experience and be able to harness for the good of themselves and mankind. That the brain and consciousness, or you like to say brain and mind, which is exactly not the same, have to come together to work. So we more often disagree here than agree, because all these subjects, it is very difficult to agree. So you would see that we are a dialogue place, and you have agreed to dialogue. In that context, we would be very delighted with your inputs and very honest inputs. We have asked you some very direct and simple questions as to, when you go back, how you believe you would make a difference to organization. We want you to suggest us what we should do which would make a difference to the country. And believe me, those things we analyze very carefully, and then some have become always a part of our program. Having said that, I'd say that we are very fortunate to have Chris Gopalakrishnan. We all know he is the co-founder of the Infosys. He has been the chief executive officer and managing director, has been the vice chairman. More important, Asia, one of the very fertile think tank of the world. He has been among the thought leaders, and he has been chosen among the critical thinkers and thought leaders in the Asia. And you would imagine it is very easy to say this, but to be in Asia on the top of a thought leader or critical thinking is a quality which speaks about Chris Gopalakrishnan. He has been interested in education. He has been chairman board of governors of the IIT Madras and Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, two very premier institutes. That's why I said that he has experienced education. Today, he is retired. He is not retired, but he is retired. And retired, when you know that sometimes you get more buoyancy and more speed on the track. So he is very deeply interested in many subjects like brain search, stem cell research, education. I've heard him a few times on education and all that. So I think, like all of you, I always say I'm looking forward to listen to Chris Gopalakrishnan this morning. And I think it is something that after this talk, when it is over, we are going to miss you. I'm going to miss you. I don't know we I can use or not. I talked to you over lunch, tea, became family, and I hope to see you more number of times in your organization, in NIAS, but definitely working for the country one way or the other. Thank you very much. I invite Ms. Chris Gopalakrishnan.
Thank you very much, and good morning to all of you. You know, the program is called To Lead a Change, and Dr. Baldev Raj, you know, gave a very brief of what happened during the week. You know, two things he talked about, you know, a dialogue. So I'll make the presentation. These are like, you know, for me, notes, and I will talk through that. Maybe at the end of each slide, if you have any question on that slide, you can stop and you know, we can have a dialogue, or you can wait till the end. It doesn't matter. The second thing I want to mention from his brief talk, the inequality. It's very interesting because my presentation ends with trying to address that. So we'll come back to that at the end, actually. What I have tried to do today is based on my experience over the last 35, 40 years and my understanding of the industry that I was in, and I am still in, which is the IT industry. So my experience with the industry, my experience with industry in general in India, because I've been very active with the Confederation of Indian Industries. I've seen how India has changed. And, you know, I think this is a senior leadership forum, so many of you are aware of the period before 1991 and the period after 1991. So my experience seeing the transition, and what the future, what the next 30 years hold for us, actually, which you are going to impact through your organizations, your work, etc. And that's how I've structured this presentation. Looking forward a little bit, looking backwards, and then coming back to looking forward. So we'll go back and forth, actually. And the reason for that is, we are at the beginning of what World Economic Forum is calling the fourth industrial revolution. I was fortunate to be part of the third industrial revolution, which is the digital revolution. It's assumed that the third industrial revolution started in the late 60s. Third industrial revolution is about digital computing and the impact of digital computing on all of us. And somewhere now, or maybe it has already started, it's very difficult to actually exactly, precisely say when something like this starts. So it's assumed that we are either at the beginning or this revolution is going to start. And there are many things about this revolution that are going to be very interesting. And I want to, so that's why I want to look forward, then come back and look at the third industrial revolution, which I was part of, and then go back to the fourth industrial revolution. This is something I picked up on the web. It's a cartoon where the person sitting there is trying to write down things which computers can't do. And then on the floor you can see those which he had already posted, he has to strike off and then throw it on the floor, right? Only humans can play master chess. No longer true, right? Now computers can beat the best people on chess. Only humans can guide a missile. Only humans can improvise jazz. Can understand natural language. I think computers can start understanding natural language. Now, things which are there on the wall, still only humans can review a movie. I think it's probably slightly dated. Now it's even possible to review articles, texts, and things like that. So this is an indication of what is in front of us. Many things we thought humans can only do, we are now seeing that computers and digital technology and a combination of digital, physical, and biological. And that's what is the fourth industrial revolution is about. The third industrial revolution was about simply digital technology. But the fourth industrial revolution is an opportunity to bring physical things. So anything that you want to track, anything that you want to monitor, anything that you want to use will have some intelligence embedded into it, a processing embedded into it. And you've talked, heard about Internet of Things and like that. So anything that you want to use can have intelligence, it can be tracked, it can actively participate. It can provide information, it can provide data, it can make some decisions. That's on the physical side. Of course, digital will continue. And then on the biological side, now we assume, there are many aspects to this actually. One is to connect biological systems to digital systems. It's a simple, And a very early example, this is from the third industrial revolution, is the GPS on our car automatically rerouting our car. And then we just follow, right? So human-computer interaction with some decision making. Now there's also tests being done to connect the brain directly to the computer, and by just thinking, we are able to interface with the computer. Of course, that's very early stage, but it's possible to think about these things. You may have heard about monitoring the vital statistics of an individual using Fitbit and things like that, right? And more advanced ones where you can look at sugar levels or pulse and things like that. And it's also feasible to think about more advanced ones where you're actually using sensors that, you know, you swallow, sensors that are embedded within you, that are putting electrodes into the brain. People who are blind are able to see. So a lot of new technology is coming. And that's the blurring of biological systems and digital systems. So this is again part of the fourth industrial revolution. A simple, very simple graph. Human performance is going up linearly, whereas computer performance is actually increasing exponentially. I have a slide a little bit later about one dimension of this computer performance, which we have. I'm just going to take off my jacket for better. One dimension of computer performance where the computers exceeded human performance, it's numerical computing. A computer can today execute billion arithmetic operations in a second, billion plus arithmetic operations in a second. In a single dimension, it has far, far exceeded human capability. Where it has not exceeded, so detecting or identifying people in a picture. Early trials are on. You know, you may have heard about Google Photo, right, where it is able to recognize faces and things like that, but many a time it also makes mistakes. But the capability will only improve as time goes on. And that's why this graph says we are somewhere below, because in certain dimensions the computers are terrible, but in certain other dimensions they are already exceeding human performance, and overall the performance actually would exceed some time. Now there is debate about what this time frame is. Ray Kurzweil, a futurist, believes that this time frame is in the next 30 years, next 15, 20 years actually. And there are other people who are saying, you know, it may be 50 years from now, but we don't know. But it is, if you look at narrowly defined dimensions, the computer is starting to exceed human capability. And these are all going to have significant consequences on what all of us do as leaders. All of us will have to think as leaders. All of us will have to also look at issues, philosophical issues related to this. What should be done and what should not be done. There are now people like Bill Gates. Even Bill Gates has said that artificial intelligence, machine learning can harm human race. Elon Musk, you know, these are very respected leaders from the technology community. They've raised alarm. Stephen Hawking has raised an alarm saying that computers can harm the human race. So these are issues now we need to understand and we need to ask. It is only by asking, by only discussing, dialogue, etc., we can do this. Now, I strongly believe that India can contribute positively in multiple dimensions. And that is the reason why I am investing into research on brain in India. One, of course, by joining this research effort, we add capacity. For every $5 spent in the US, if $1 is spent in India, I strongly believe that we can double the research output. That $1 can be sourced in India. You know, that's something that we can do. But if we have to join the international effort, and we can double the output. And if we double the output, we get early solutions, maybe early cures. We can reduce the cost of the cure, because instead of $10, now we are spending only $6. And it will be beneficial to India, so it's win-win for everybody. India, because we get the solution at a lower cost, we are part of building that solution, and we take advantage of this revolution that's happening. And that's the reason why I am investing in that. And this is also based on my own experience, and I'll come to that actually. India can also contribute because we have a spiritual tradition unlike other civilizations. And we have a tradition of looking at nature, understanding nature, a holistic view of the world and things like that. I think that is also a positive contribution, because some of these questions blur the line between science and spirituality. And of course, you know, Dr. Beldevraj said, you know, NIAS is a place for discussion, dialogue and disagreement. But I think it's a good question to actually pose and ask. And I feel that this is something India can contribute positively by adding to this discussion and dialogue that's happening, because this is very important. In the next 30 years, if it happens, and that means in our generation, we are going to see computers exceeding capability of human beings. That is a significant milestone. And it's very much possible to see it. In one dimension, I said it has far exceeded numerical computation. It has far exceeded human capability. Dimension by dimension, it is going to exceed. And one fine day, we wake up and realize almost anything human beings can do, it's going to do better. Autonomous cars. Imagine what happens. You know, somebody, I read somewhere, somebody had postulated that there are 3 million drivers in the US. And if autonomous cars come, these 3 million drivers would be without job. This is just the US. So there are many, many consequences. The car industry, as we know, would be overturned overnight, because people need not buy cars. And if you can get a car within 2 minutes of your requirement, actually it's preferable to use that, because you don't have to worry about parking. You know, you can just get in, relax, it'll take you where you want to go, automatically debit your bank account. You don't have to worry about anything. You know, it's a clean car, you can continue to work, everything. And you don't have to invest also. You use it when you need it. Today, 85-90% of the time, the car is not used, but you have paid for it fully. Underutilization of an asset. World would reduce the number of cars, because people won't buy cars and leave it unused most of the time. It can reduce pollution, all kinds of things actually. So industry structures would get overturned overnight. All these are possibilities in the future in this fourth industrial revolution. So just looking back, the first industrial revolution, steam engine, water, mechanical production equipment. The second industrial revolution, 1870, electric motors and things like factories, mass production. The third industrial revolution, around 1969, electronics, automated production, simple digitization. And the fourth industrial revolution, I'm saying 2015, physical plus digital plus biological systems, a combination of technologies. If you look at, and you may have seen this actually, and this is just a snapshot over about 120, 130 years actually, and if you go back also, we can have a better idea of this. But it's again to illustrate a point here. If you just look at India, 16% of the global GDP, and industrial revolution, you know, I said 1870, started declining dramatically. Of course, we were also ruled by a foreign entity. We came down. The digital revolution happened around 1970, and it started picking up. We were also part of the global economy from that point onwards, and now it's approximately 6%. US, twenty-seven percent, but dramatic growth here, and again growth here. Of course, now other countries are catching up actually, and so it's 19%. China has gone up, and it's 19%. Europe started declining when the U.S. went up. It didn't do too well during the digital revolution. Now it's picked up quite dramatically, actually. Sorry, that's China. Europe is, Okay, the colors are actually, sorry. The colors are wrong. So this is US, I'm sorry. 2%, because that's when US was discovered and things like that, around that time, 1700s. So it was actually very small, and yes, this is very clear now. So you can see that US grew on top of the Industrial Revolution, and the second Industrial Revolution, and dramatically grew during the World War and the third Industrial Revolution. It's 19% of the global economy today. Europe is, this is Europe actually, 27%. It grew in the second Industrial Revolution, didn't do too well during the wars or the third Industrial Revolution. It's 19% today. So these things have significant impact when you look at over a period of time. And it's actually these impacts are now becoming faster because things happen much faster in an accelerated time frame. And that's why I'm saying in a generation, now we can see these changes happening. Why am I saying things will happen in an accelerated fashion? And I'm just looking at, I'm going backwards now. I'm looking at the third Industrial Revolution. The next two, three slides is about the third Industrial Revolution, what I lived through actually. So I got introduced to computers actually in 1978 at IIT Madras. I was doing my MSc Physics, and it's very interesting. You know, things sometimes happen by accident, by luck, and then you look back and wonder, you know, why. So I was going from the library to my hostel on a bicycle. Afternoon, around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, with three books at the back of my, you know, in the carrier of my cycle, and somebody called me from behind, also on a cycle, said, "Stop," and I stopped, and he said, "What are you reading?" These were three books on computer science, and he said, "There is a Fortran class in the campus. Why don't you attend that class? If you attend the class, you will actually get access to the computer center." Because in those days, there was limited access. Only people who were either doing computer science or had reason to use the computer were allowed access to the computer. So you will get access to the computer center. I took the Fortran class. It was a free class because You see, those were the days, early days of computers in India, and free classes were offered to popularize computers and things like that. So I took the class, got access. I changed my field from physics to computer science, did a master's in computer science, and got into this industry. The person who stopped me was Professor Mahabala. Imagine both of us being at the same place at the same time. I don't think Professor Mahabala had a habit of stopping people riding on cycle. He decided somehow or other to stop me. I don't know why. And the dialogue started, and he asked me to do this, etc., etc. So if you look at, evolution of microchip, the integrated circuit, 1958 when it was invented, two transistors. The gate length is the distance between the transistors is half an inch. Because how many more transistors is better, because more intelligence actually, more processing capability, etc. In 1981, Intel introduced the 4004 chip for 2,300 transistors, the gate length of 10,000 nanometers, the speed of 740 kilohertz, not even megahertz. Cost per transistor approximately $1. In 2012, NVIDIA introduced the graphic processing unit chip, 7.1 billion transistors. Gate length of 28 nanometers, speed of 7 gigahertz, and the cost per transistor is approximately 10 to the power of minus 7 dollar. 10 to the power of minus 7 dollar. 100 billion fold improvement in 40 years. So you understand how exponential this is. That is the reason why today, the computer can do billion numerical computations per second. That's why every one of us has a supercomputer in our pocket. Cost has come down dramatically. The processor now is, $3, $5. Raspberry Pi, they now manufacture these hobby computers, has released something called Raspberry Zero. Every school student should probably get one of these things, because with that you can play around with computers. You can program for the lights to come on when you come in, etc., etc. That's just $5. Probably in large numbers the price will be even lower. Every single student we should now give in school should get a Raspberry Zero computer. Kerala government actually is doing this. Last year, they gave 2,500 Raspberry Pi computers to school students, 8th grade students. And this year, they gave 7,500 free. They select these students through some competition. They're given, they're actually taught a little bit of programming, and they're asked to play around with it. And the person who got the first prize, the student who got the first prize, is an 8th grade student from Kannur, developed an application to monitor civil servants in government offices, attendance system. And it's connected to the internet. So you can go to the internet and actually see whether that person is present or not before you go to that office. Right? Very intelligent person. That's what is, it's an 8th grade student. And this is a non-trivial application. That is what has been enabled using these computers. Cost has come down dramatically, and power has increased dramatically. Moore's law talks about this actually. The power, he said power doubles every 18 months and the cost comes down by half. But this has far exceeded actually what his predictions were. Let's look at how India has participated in this revolution. and the possibility of change that can happen. You know, we can have a full discussion on this because these are unintended consequences of decisions that were made. And very interesting to go back and look at whether that was the goal of those decisions. Those were the goals of those decisions. So in 1977, Government of India, primarily targeting IBM, Coca-Cola, etc., said that foreign ownership should be less than 50%. These companies decided that they will not dilute below 51%, so they were forced to leave India. IBM had a significant presence. Most of the computer systems in India were IBM. So entrepreneurship emerged. Entrepreneurs came to maintain these systems. It also allowed mini computers to enter in India. Digital Equipment Corporation, HP, Data General, Wang, Prime, etc., etc., to enter into India. So entrepreneurship, lots of new companies were set up in late 70s, early 80s. And I strongly believe that one of the drivers was IBM vacating the space here in India and allowed these companies to be started. Infosys, of course, was founded in 1981. The economic liberalization of 1991 helped the industry. Foreign companies actually were allowed back into India in 1993. So IBM actually came back to India in 1993 and set up a 100% owned subsidiary, because 100% foreign direct investment was allowed in computers industry in 1993. As part of the liberalization. This was the first sector that was completely opened up. The industry was actually very small, about, I think, $100, $150 million of revenue, employing about 150,000 people in 1993. 22 years back. That's why I said I've lived through all these things. Now, if you fast forward to today, the industry clocks a revenue of $150 billion. 8% approximately of India's GDP. Exports of $120 billion, about 20% of our exports. Employs 4 million people. In fact, in the formal sector, the organized sector is supposed to have about 50, 55 million people employed. The industry has created approximately 4 million jobs in the last 20, 22 years. So the largest employment creation in the last 10 years in the organized sector is supposed to be the IT industry, IT and BPO industry. Today, majority of the Fortune 500 companies have their back office in India. Most of them, majority of them here in Bangalore, actually. And several multinationals have their R&D facility also in India, many again in Bangalore. Look at the impact this had on our economy. It changed the perception in India, changed the quality perception of India, increased the dependence. And we had a delegation of US congressmen visiting Bangalore, and they said, we are intricately, our economy is intricately connected to the economy of India. If there is a one-day bump in Bangalore, and I can tell you from experience, we would get calls from the US. Is my back office operating? What do I need to do? Because this bump is affecting the Wall Street. It's affecting a retailer, intricately connected and tied to the US economy and the global economy. And many people believe Bangalore doesn't belong to India, Bangalore belongs to the world. It's an international city, unlike many other cities, actually. We don't think about it that way. But, you know, we are part of the third industrial revolution. We benefited from the third industrial revolution. We created an industry, world-class industry, from nothing. In a lifetime, less than a lifetime, 20 years, out of almost nothing, created very good employment, changed the lives of many people. And if you look at the NASSCOM report, for every job created in the IT industry, 5 or 6 jobs or 8 jobs are created in associated, you know, support industries and things like that. So the total employment created is significantly higher because of the growth of this industry. Bangalore, again, is a unique city because Bangalore has a population of about 8 million. Approximately 800,000 to 1 million. These numbers are actually very difficult, but it's definitely somewhere between 800,000 to 1 million. People are directly employed by the IT BPO industry, which means that 1 in 10 person in Bangalore is directly employed. The per capita income of Bangalore is almost double the per capita income of the country because of the industry. We are actually a very rich city. And the average age in Bangalore is actually 27 years old. Bangalore is actually a very young city. And there are other things which we can talk about. 80% of the people in Bangalore were not born in Bangalore. It's a city of immigrants, all kinds of things. Anyway, these are the reasons why we need to study the impact of this. And we can actually probably plan these things. You know, some visionaries decided that this is something that is going to have impact, but I can tell you that nobody really, really thought that this would be this big. Of course, every 5 years we can project next 5 years what it will be, etc. And now there are projections that from 150 billion we will go to 300 billion in 2020, right? So near time projection is possible, but beyond that. But in 1987, when the software technology policy was created, I don't think we could have imagined this. When the first telecommunication link from India to US was created, again in Bangalore, Texas Instruments set up the first telecommunication link between Bangalore and US, Texas in US actually. I don't think. And there are interesting stories. I'm actually trying to document the history of IT in India through interviews and things like that actually. And interesting stories. So the first time the data communication link was set up, it is seen as export, right? So there's a customs officer sitting adjacent to where the link terminates to see actually what is going on this link. And I don't know what he saw or what he was checking. But there was a customs officer sitting there trying to understand what is being exported. Interesting stories to talk about actually. But imagine the change that has happened. And that's why, you know, I also want you to keep in your mind what is possible. Now, this is not just IT. The telecom revolution also has seen exponential growth, and we have leapfrogged. And this is, again, an opportunity for India. We can leapfrog. So if you look at the telecom revolution, 3 million subscribers approximately in 1991, 37 in 2001, and almost a billion subscribers, second largest in the world. Growth over 20 times in 12 years. 300 million internet subscribers, mostly on the phone, second largest in the world, fastest growing market, best in service and lowest tariff. We've connected all our people, almost all our people, empowered them, given them access, given them, now an ability to do lot of, you know, avail of lot of services, banking, healthcare, education, etc., etc. Identity. And we never went to fixed line. We directly went to mobile. We leapfrogged. And again, this is an opportunity. Later on, you will find that one of the elements of this next industrial revolution is about new storage technologies for energy. Because we still need electricity to power these computers. etc. We need better technology in the power sector, electricity from renewable sources, for example. And we have very ambitious targets on the electricity side, 175 gigawatts from renewable sources. That's what our Prime Minister has said. A very audacious target. And I like it, because when it's an audacious target, you have to think about disruptive ideas, disruptive technologies. You have to think about new ways of doing things. And this is an opportunity for us to leapfrog. Why go through the traditional route of looking at from fossil fuels and things like that? Let's just leapfrog and, you know, just go to the future. Here is an example. In 20 years, we have gone to the future. We have better applications and services on the mobile phone than the developed countries, because the developed countries did not need it, necessity. We needed it, and the consumers wanted it. There's a market for doing that, and hence we have better applications on the mobile phone than developed countries. Again, you know, my theme is about transformation, right? Disruption. Look at, as of today, the market cap of 5 digital economy companies and market cap of 5, I'm calling old economy companies, which have not changed ahead of the curve, which is slowly changing, but these on the right side are the companies which are seen as the giants of the second industrial revolution. GM, manufacturing cars, $46 billion. Walmart, the largest physical retailer in the world, $198 billion market cap. Citigroup, one of the largest banks in the world, $120 billion. British Petroleum, BP, oil, $89 billion, Sony from Japan, $29 billion. So two of them are headquartered outside US actually. It's a global phenomenon, not just US actually. And on the left side, some companies which were not there actually, you know, Facebook came out in the last 15 years, or maybe even last 10 years actually, $266 billion. Amazon in the late 90s actually, $270 billion. Microsoft was able to transition from the second. Microsoft was there in 1981 when the PC was introduced. That's when they released their MS-DOS operating system. That's the start of Microsoft, really. $403 billion. Google with search after internet in the late 90s. $493 billion. Apple spans the start of the digital revolution again. $534 billion. And there are some people who are saying that Apple could be the first company, could be, which hits the $1 trillion market cap. Value changes when the industrial revolution happens. Again, extremely important for us to understand and learn in our businesses, in our decision making and things like that. When we think about Indian economy, where we want to provide support, where we want to invest, where we want to look at economic value creation and things like that. We need to take the right decisions. Looking forward, actually, and it continues to be interesting, and we don't even know what companies are going to emerge in the fourth industrial revolution, actually, and so I'm still in this third industrial revolution. These are companies which are private, funded by private equity, venture capitalists, etc., etc. Uber, estimated value $51 billion. It's a taxi service. But it has become the largest taxi service, does not recognize national boundaries. It's there everywhere. They don't own any assets. asset-light model, which has now become the new model. Airbnb is actually even more interesting. They have become the largest hotel chain in the world. And because of the asset-light nature, they didn't build a single room. Imagine a Hilton, which is the second largest. If they want to build a hotel, they will take 2 years. In India, probably they'll take 5 years because you have to get all the approvals necessary, etc., etc. Airbnb will add the same number of rooms in 1 month. In 1 month, they will add the same number of rooms. They have become the largest hotel in probably 2 years in the world. Acceleration. When you rethink, when the business model changes, and they're valued at 26 billion. You know, if you ask a youngster between 10 and 20, maybe, I don't know, 8 and 20, I don't know, they're becoming younger and younger actually, the application they would use to communicate with each other is Snapchat, messaging application. It's valued at $16 billion. Of course, here we see Flipkart, our own creation here in Bangalore, which is a marketplace. Again, an asset-light model. They started with some assets and things like that, but by and large, they're an asset-light model. They have modeled themselves similar to Amazon and things like that, valued at $15 billion. So we need to actually encourage, create these kind of companies. SpaceX is actually private endeavor to actually send spacecraft to the space. You know, deploy satellites and things like that in the private sector. That's valued at about $12 billion. So this is a combination of new possibilities, new business models, etc. You know, NIAS will have a particularly important role because even if you go to the best business schools in the world, Uber or Airbnb model did not come out of any business school. Business schools will follow. They will write now case studies about these things. Why Uber succeeded. But the model didn't come from any business school. It came in the mind of some individual. And places like NIAS, cross-disciplinary, you know, what is possible, what can we imagine? I think there is an opportunity for think tanks, etc., to maybe... And the way to do this is, I strongly believe now, we need to have entrepreneurship workshops. What businesses can we create? What wild ideas can we think of and support? And that is why Bangalore has an important role to play for the rest of India and the rest of the world, because Bangalore is 12th best place for startups, the best in India for startups. This is where future businesses are being incubated in India. Very, very important. The wildest possible ideas using the latest thinking and the latest in technology. The latest in technology, unfortunately, Bangalore is lagging behind, and that's again why I am investing in research. We are lagging behind, and that's the reason why Bangalore is number 12. Because in terms of numbers, we are probably third in terms of startups and things like that. But when you rank a city in terms of its ecosystem, Bangalore ranks 12th. Because we don't have the research interface into startups yet. Ideas from laboratories creating new businesses. But it's important for us to actually do this. Now, history plays a very important role in how systems are developed and when it comes to legacy systems. Can I go on till 11? Yeah, yeah. No, I will finish in the next 10 minutes, actually, and then we'll have discussion. History plays a role. So if you look at traditionally how you develop systems, and I took the healthcare example, every hospital will develop their own IT system. Insurance companies will have their own IT systems. Then you decide that, okay, a patient may go from one hospital to another hospital. Something like this, that entire industry, how it should be structured in the future. You start with the customer, who is the patient, at the center. The data is actually owned by the patient. It belongs to the patient. And there should be a repository on the cloud, which actually holds. Does not belong to the hospital, does not belong to the insurance company. Then when the patient goes to a hospital, he authorizes them to access the data from the cloud. They will add whatever procedures they did, etc., and store it back into the cloud. Now the patient goes to another hospital, all he or she has to do is authorize them to access that data, and the latest information is available on the cloud. Hospitals gain because they don't have to store millions or lakhs of patient records. Even hospitals are challenged today because they're not able to keep up actually. You go to a physician, the physician also can access the data from the cloud. Better architecture for a system. And so this is the advantage of leapfrogging. Now, if India has to develop an ecosystem for healthcare, we should actually be developing this, because except for maybe a handful of hospitals, the chains, we don't have computerization in hospitals. That's the reason why I picked up this example. And we can actually leapfrog and create a better ecosystem for IT in healthcare here in India. Now we can think of other applications actually. You go to banking, KYC based on Aadhaar. Today every bank is doing KYC. Why are they wasting the resources, the time, effort, etc., etc.? And the benefit of that, if you want, you can get a single view of all your accounts across all banks, all your investments across all investment vehicles using that single ID. In fact, there is an effort in the US now to retrofit this. Banks are coming together to create a customer record on the cloud so that the customer can get a single view of all their investments from the cloud. And of course, these are all private. So even governments cannot access them without permission of the customer, of the individual. We have to rethink systems. Industry will have to come together to develop, and everybody will benefit, including the individual banks will benefit, individual hospitals will benefit, everybody will benefit. We have to rethink these things as we develop systems. Aadhaar, when it's complete, will be the largest database of identity in the world, and no other country has it. Absolutely no other country has it. We should raise it to a national level project, because that's what is very, very important in the digital age. Identity is the most important thing in the digital age. And it enables so many services to be delivered seamlessly and better. We have to rise up to the occasion. We have to leapfrog. So now I gave you a glimpse of the impact of the third industrial revolution, the digital age, the industry that was created here, the economic benefit that happened, the jobs that were created, and luckily, we were part of this. We have not taken full advantage of this. Some areas we are taking full advantage of it. Telecom is an example of where we have actually leapfrogged. We didn't go through several generations of telecom technology here in India. We just leapfrogged. We can leapfrog in healthcare. We can leapfrog in every other sector. We can actually leapfrog in power systems today. 1.75 gigahertz, we could be the first. Cochin Airport is the first airport in the entire world that's powered by solar. Fully powered by solar. We can do this here in India. Huge number of technologies are emerging actually, and these are some of the things now that are driving the fourth industrial revolution. And I won't go into this, I just want to, you know, place it here so that you can think about these things. Actually, you would have heard of Internet of Things. That means everything has intelligence built in. Machine learning, where, see, the traditional mode of using computers is you write a program, feed it to the computer, and the computer uses this program to provide answers to you. The new model of computing, or one of the models of computing, is the computer learns. It looks at sample input, sample output. You tell the computer, okay, for this input, these are right answers. So you tell the computer what are the right answers, and it figures out how to transform the input to get to the output. It figures it out. And you give large number of examples, it'll figure out better and better, because it gets the complete answers, set of answers. And this is why machine learning is used for recognition of people, you know, face recognition. It's used for natural language detection and things like that. It's a very important technology in the future. Cloud is a very important technology for the future, because every smartphone can be connected to a cloud, and you can have infinite processing and infinite storage in the hands of these 2-3 billion people who have smartphones. That means everybody has access to a supercomputer. And you pay for every second that you use, so it's affordable to everybody. I recently created a grant for NCBS on stem cell research. The reason why I'm very optimistic about this, I'm supporting this, is because with stem cell research, you know, with stem cells, you can actually take blood from the same individual and look at mutations. See, what happens is our cells are continuously regenerating. Millions and millions of billions of times, actually, new cells are being created. And what happens is, as you age, the mutations increase. Right? Now, if you can actually, and these are our own cells, so our antibodies are not able to attack them and distinguish them. So it does not recognize bad cells versus good cells. They are all our cells. And as the mutation increases, organ starts failing, cancer comes, etc. One of the possibilities. So with stem cell research, actually, we can edit this, inject it back into the patient. It's their own cells, and it will not reject, but it will actually now start doing certain other things, actually. And so cures are possible using stem cell gene editing. So lots of new technologies are there. But we have to, of course, think about the ethics behind this and wonder about the ethics. Of course, that's normal for any new thing, actually. So wonderful, interesting technologies emerging. I've talked about some of the things, battery storage technology and things like that. Autonomous vehicles. So I said I will come to inequality. As we look at the future, as the power of computing keeps on increasing, as we create these new, as we start using these new technologies, 3D printing, for example, can replace manufacturing, at least in certain categories of products. Automation substitutes labor. Return on capital versus return on labor. Low skill, low pay versus high skill, high pay. The income starts accumulating with providers of intellectual capital and physical capital rather than to labor. So the people who benefit are innovators, shareholders, investors. We have already seen this. Digital revolution, the third industrial revolution, increased disparity under every form of government. China, autocratic. Russia, of course, that's because of resources-led economy. India, democratic. US, democratic. Every single country has seen disparity increase. So World Economic Forum did an interesting study between 2015 and 2020. This is the last slide I have. Where will the jobs be created and where will jobs be lost? And the highest on the left, office and administrative, 4.7. This is limited to about 300 companies, global companies, across, I think, if I remember right, those 300 companies have 7 million employees, I think, 7 million employees. 4.7 million jobs will be lost. I think 20 million employees. 4.7 million jobs will be lost in office and administrative tasks in the next 5 years. And on the other side, 492,000 jobs will be created in business and finance operations, 416 in management, 405 in computers and mathematical, etc., etc. The next is 1.6 million jobs will be lost in manufacturing and production because of robotics and automation and things like that. The number of jobs lost is a total 7 million. Number of jobs created, total 2 million. Net 5 million jobs are lost. This is across 300 companies employing about 20 million people or something like that. So what I wanted to convey today is significant changes are happening. I lived through the third industrial revolution, the digital revolution, all of you actually. But I was integral part of this. I was experiencing it, living through that. I was part of making it happen and I saw what happened and I saw the benefit that it brought to India, you know, wealth that it was created, you know, Infosys growing, and the benefits of it. I saw us as a country leapfrogging in telecom and the benefit that it brought to our country, to our citizens, empowering them, etc., etc. There are opportunities to leapfrog in other sectors. Banking, we have actually leapfrogged, so we have enabled, but the new companies, the payment companies that are coming are not the banks, unfortunately. They are the Paytms of the world. And so there is an issue with legacy businesses, and you saw the impact of not making this transformation when it comes to market cap and value. We are at the beginning of the fourth industrial revolution, I strongly believe, which is going to be even more transformational than the third industrial revolution. Even more transformational, because now the power of the computers are going to far exceed the power of the human beings. Several dimensions, autonomous cars and things like that. Several dimensions they are going to exceed the power of human beings. And the consequences can be significant. We need to understand. We need to be part of this. We need to make it happen. We have to be an integral part. We can, with 4 million IT professionals in India, and because this is going to be driven by IT, with our research institutions, this research community that is there in India, we can actually be at the center of this change that is happening. And we can take full advantage of this. Thank you.
To come here for question and
answer. Okay, I'll go.
Friends, you would agree with me that Chris Gopalakrishnan has really opened our minds. I have to be disciplined, otherwise I myself can dialogue on many of the issues, but the opportunity is yours. And in the limited time, I request you to raise the issues. I'd go purely the priority wise. Who would register first would get the first opportunity. So 1, 2, 3. So I'd go that way and then come this way. So there and then this way and then that way. Yes, please. Today we can break our discipline, go 15 minutes more if Chris is available. Because we shouldn't miss this opportunity to dialogue with him. And the high definition video and the voice has been recorded. And I believe my colleague Sindhu would be happy to provide to any of those who would like to carry forward and discuss with your colleagues, because there are many, many issues which we should critically think over, you know.
Pathani.
Sir, this was one of the, when the list of lectures was given to us, this was one of the lectures we were looking forward to. And I'm happy to note that you have not disappointed us at all, sir. My questions are two, sir. First, as you mentioned about the artificial intelligence, that this is going to harm humans, and therefore, possibly, if I understand, that we are not going to research into it too much. Today, the internet geeks and the people who are researching on the internet, I fear that if the industry doesn't do it, somebody else will, and then like a computer virus, which it started off and then we do firefighting, I hope that situation doesn't arise, that individuals will create artificial intelligence for the benefit of individuals, and thereafter we are doing firefighting to see how we can overcome this. That is number one, sir. And the second is about the net neutrality. You will agree that Infosys or any of the other IT companies that have come up in India have proliferated and done well mainly because of the net neutrality. Today, Facebook and others are trying to propagate Facebook and so on, and you, having been a pioneer in the internet and this technology, I hope you are, besides other things, taking active part to ensure that the net remains neutral. Your view, sir.
So, very quickly on the second, you know, I have actually supported net neutrality already publicly, and I agree. That is something we have to push for in our country, and there are many other things that we need to push for, including, you know, the data about our entities and our citizens residing within the country, etc., our borders, because that's part of national security. Mr. Karthikeyan is here, you know, he understands this much better than anybody else. So on the second, you know, my answer is very simple, and I'm an advocate for that. On the first, it is actually quite a bit of challenge, because we do not know the consequences and what technology can do. We are experimenting, right? Unfortunately, the bad elements are also experimenting. We are bound by rules, regulations, policies, bureaucracy, etc., etc. Whereas the bad elements are not. So we are always at a disadvantage. The only way we can do this is by, you know, rethinking how governments, you know, work with new technology, new inventions and things like that, coming out with new processes for governments to also experiment with things. Governments also sometimes adopting certain things, understanding in a limited way, understanding that we fully don't understand this yet. And maybe accepting that failures are possible, mistakes are possible, and we accept those consequences. So we have to do this differently. You know, automobile has not changed much in 100 years. You know, it's got four doors, an engine, and you have to sit inside, drive, etc., etc. Now, of course, it's changing. And it'll change very fast, actually. So we have to figure out, you know, should we experiment and allow these autonomous vehicles and try to understand the consequences, accept that some accidents may happen, some mistakes will be made, rather than wait for fully developed systems and things like that. That is the only way we can actually be on par. We probably cannot be ahead, but at least be on par. We need to understand these things. We need to understand, you know, the benefits, you know, the ills of this, etc. Ultimately, if we are in control, see, that's the key. If we are in control, and we make those decisions in a conscious way, there is a hope. That's how I would look at it.
Yes, please. Sir, I would like to have your views on the data being uploaded through Aadhaar and many other systems, how safe it would be. We know Pentagon, NASA, Indian Army, forces, websites have been hacked. So where do we stand with respect to so much of data being available on cloud or net?
See, there are techniques to encrypt it, techniques to distribute it, and techniques to secure it as best as we can and make it very difficult for it to be broken in. There are positives of having a central database and negatives of having a distributed database and not having such things. But the benefits, I believe, far outweigh the risk that we need to take. And we must consciously use the best technology possible, available, to secure it. And we also make it very difficult or very costly for people who break in. That is the only solution. Not doing it and not giving this advantage to millions and millions of people is not the right answer. I strongly believe that, you know, you openly tell people, this is why we are doing it, these are the benefits, these are some of the possible consequences, this is how we are protecting the data. In a way in which, of course, that doesn't allow people to now break in, because you can't be transparent about what you're doing in protecting the data. But, you know, you can at the highest level say that these are the things that we are doing. That is the future. Unfortunately, I believe it's fortunately that's the future, because, you know, there are many other things. You know, you are getting spammed, you're getting, people know, you know. Today, I'm telling you, everything about us is known. Everything about, if you have a credit card, if you have a phone, if you have, if you have a TV at home, everything about you is known. Okay, the mobile phone knows more about you than anybody else in the world, including yourself.
Yes, please.
Please.
We have many colleagues asking.
Okay, sir.
Maybe over tea if you are lucky to catch hold of.
So there are two things, sir. One is a comment. You had mentioned earlier that as over the years we find that the computers continue to overpass or surpass the humans in many activities. There were two things which perhaps imagination and humor. I don't know whether this can ever be surpassed. It's just a comment, sir. I do not know. I would like invite your views. And the second is that as we continue into the digital age and we interact, human performance, I do not know whether it's ever going to increase. Rather, I think we are getting rewired, and I think the effect can be seen on coming generations. It's going to affect human performance, perhaps adversely, and we need to, I think, factor that into many of our predictions and whether the way we are going is really the way we should.
Okay. See, imagination and humor, I don't want to say that, we will continue to be better, but those are more difficult for computers to actually come up with, because it is on the question of emotion, conscious, what is humor itself, defining that, it's quite subjective, not objective. Because the current programming model is we need to understand something, program it, and the computer will replicate it. You know, that's the current programming model. Machine learning is a different programming model. We don't even have to understand how things happen. See, today we recognize faces, but can you now write a program to recognize face? That's where we are failing. So we are saying that's the model we don't want to follow now. Okay, the model that we will follow now, or the new model that's emerging, is we tell the computer, these are all the different faces. You know, if the computer has actually 7 billion faces in the world, and it can easily have that, it will recognize every single of the 7 billion faces better than any human being, any collection of human beings, because no human being can remember 7 billion human faces. The computer can, right? So that's the change that is happening. And so I don't want to exclude anything, actually, that computers can't do better. To the second question, from the beginning of time, we have always augmented human capabilities using tools and technology. Take a car. You run as fast as you can. There's a limit of how fast you can reach this destination. You get into a car, you can reach there faster.
10 times faster. You get into a plane, 100 times faster, 1,000 times faster. Right? We have conquered movement, augmenting our capability by technology. Now, should we say that we should not have planes? Because planes sometimes create accidents, kill people. Simple example. It is how we use it, how we understand the benefits and the, you know, the destructive power of something like that. Even fire. Fire can kill people. But we have learned to manage fire. From the beginning of time, we humans have leveraged technology to effectively amplify our capabilities. Computers are also being used to amplify our capabilities, make us become better. And that is how it should be. And when the technology is invented, maybe there is a gap between we fully understand. And that's the reason why I'm actually a lot more optimistic when it comes to computers becoming better at something, because I feel that we will still use it effectively, control it, etc. I know, this is now a question. So there are two scenarios. Human race is extinct. Human race becomes super human beings. That's the other extreme. I think the end will be somewhere in between, because there will be some people who will actually use it to kill people. Right? And some people, or let's say majority of the people who will be on the other side, will augment human capabilities, amplify human capabilities.
Chirmati Atre.
So, my question relates to smart cities in India. Actually, the things that you were saying are very, very urban, mostly urban in nature, in development of technology. So is there a role that the IT industry is playing with the development of the smart cities? And secondly, why not a smart village, which is sponsored by either corporates or the government, and it shows the best IT usage in the rural sphere, and not only the urbanized, convenience-oriented services that it is more bent towards?
So, see, it starts with, unfortunately, education. The best educated people are in urban areas. They are the people who are most comfortable with technology. They are the most people who are most connected and integrated with globalization and things like that. It's part of the globalization phenomenon itself. And I agree with you, we have to make conscious effort to bring villages and the rural population. There are difficulties, and I think the difficulties probably can be overcome using technology itself. You know, so healthcare, using telemedicine, education. There is a gap which is a societal gap. Right, that has to be bridged to effectively bring them on par. And now who bears that cost is the question. Will industry bear the cost of bridging that gap? Or society, government should bear the cost of bridging that gap? Because that's an additional cost. You know, if I want to deploy something in Bangalore, it's easier for me, less expensive for me, than if I want to deploy it in, let's say, in a tier 3, tier 4 city or a village, etc. So, you know, interesting, but small efforts are being made. Smart villages are being created, but it does not scale because industry can do pilots, and pilots are being tried out. You know, I don't know how many of you have read through the Pura concept of President Abdul Kalam. His concept was about actually focusing on villages and creating, you know, smart villages and things like that, and holistic development of villages, etc., bringing all. So we have to, of course, look at all these things and how we enable this, because there is, at least for the transition, there's a cost involved. You know, there is an interesting slide I didn't put up, actually. If you look at the impact of the second industrial revolution, factories and electricity and things like that. Before that, society was primarily agrarian. It took almost 200 to 300 years. So the percentage of people dependent on agriculture was almost 70%. It's now 2-3% in Europe and US. But it took 250 years for that transition to happen. Now we can accelerate it using technology. Again, that's the opportunity to leapfrog for us in India.
Tarun. Tarun, please.
I know that you are a role model for many of us, and whatever you have done or whatever you have said is very well taken, and I am a great admirer, or I respect you a lot. But irrespective of that, I am damn against one thing that you said here. And that is, you know, like you, I also got to learn computers at a very late age when I joined BRC in 1994. And I also learned Fortran to begin with. And after that, I have used computers left and right in many ways. And today, I can't live without computers. I have 2 sons. But when they ask me something, I don't allow to Google them. I asked them, why did you read that book? So in that matter, I am damn against that we should give computers to our kids, because that will kill their originality. So sir, you are an icon. Whatever you say, it makes a lot of difference. People follow you. So for God's sake, please don't say that we should give computers to our kids to begin with. Let them learn following basic traditions, basic learning. From my own experience, I can say that let it be at the age of 70, if he has passion, anybody can learn computer and can do good work.
I don't completely agree, and here you can disagree, right?
Yeah.
Because what you're trying to say is, you know, inquisitiveness, curiosity, ability to learn by themselves. Now, these can happen with computers also. And you have to think about accelerating the development of these kids, actually. You know, if, let's say, that 8th grade kid who got the Raspberry Pi learned to do programming mostly by himself, actually. This, you know, he's in Kannur, actually, not a tier 1 city like, you know, Cochin or Trivandrum or something like that. He's actually in Kannur. And many of you probably don't actually know where Kannur is, or maybe have not even gone there. That child is going to be much better when he reaches college. We'll have an advantage. We'll now be able to appreciate and understand the technology much better. So I strongly believe that you need to teach them problem-solving skills using anything. You know, computer is a tool, it's a technology. And as I said, it augments human capabilities, you know, effectively using computer. See, I wrote my project report for MTech on paper, got it typed, because that's what we were doing. Today, can you imagine any college project report being done that way? It will be done on a computer, because the productivity is significantly higher, and the output looks much better quality. So I will never advocate and saying don't allow access because it's going to spoil them. Actually, if you teach them the right things, ask them the right questions, and lead them the right way, and the things are imagination, curiosity, thinking, independent thinking, problem-solving skills, questioning attitude, understanding the role of technology, limitations of technology, and you know, you have to teach them all these things, and that's what
if
is
the
important.
Chair, love, I would like to put one personal example from my.
Please.
Okay.
There are many. Nanda was one of the first ones who raised hand, so I'm mixing up. So.
I think you can't see people. There's people raising hands.
Sir, you have said that only 2-3% people in Europe are depending on agriculture. And one of my, that question was also Madam Atri said, why can't we have rural things? But exactly, the transition will take at least another 50 to 60 years, 50 years at least, that 2% of people in India will depend on agriculture. We see what is politics, what is the social system, what is the, So agriculture needs to be given a boost. That is what I think, but nothing is being done much. Actually, people, those who are into agriculture, they are the worthless people. They are all very much passionate about the land. That is that they are doing it. They don't get any satisfaction. They are just actually bound to that. So is there anything in your view that should be done or is being done?
See, the challenge is because of lack of literacy, education, semi-skilled, right? Because that skill that they know cannot be used in another sector. So for example, what happened in Europe and US, these people were moved to factories. Remember the second industrial revolution. Factories were created, and you required semi-skilled people in factories. You know, you would actually operate a lathe, or you will do some physical work, moving things around, etc., driving vehicles, etc. Unfortunately for us, the value of that, the factories are themselves getting automated. So where do you move these people? First of all, you have to figure out. And if it is a knowledge economy, this is going to be a significant challenge for India. Significant. And imagine the societal impact this would have. And the numbers are huge. So, if I remember my data right, 45% of people in India are dependent, or 50% are dependent on agriculture on a day-to-day basis. That's where they work. That is 600, 700 million people. How do you create that many number of jobs in some other sector where they can be employed today? That is why it's going to take time. It's going to pose challenge, because factories won't require that many number of people. While this is happening, we are adding 20 million people every year, new people, to the workforce. This is the youth crossing the age of, let's say, 18 or 21, joining the workforce. So you have this legacy problem of 600 million jobs, and then you have the new problem of 20 million people being added every single year, new jobs to be created. We have to think about this. Leadership has to think about this. Government has to do its thing. Industry has to do its thing. At least we are doing this national skills mission. 500 million people to be skilled in different skills. It's a huge, never done in the history of the world in such a short period of time. Never done. But we should not say that if it's never done, it's not possible. We should think, is there a solution? Is there an answer? What can we do, etc., etc.? We have to think about it. I don't have the answer.
Your opinion, what is the biggest impediment for India's growth? Is it the population, corruption, polity, bureaucracy? Because in this seminar, we have actually, no one has touched corruption. Not even a single speaker, even amongst us also. So what in your opinion is the biggest impediment for growth of India in the near future, and how to mitigate or take that particular impediment on?
See, the scale of the problem is very large. Okay, so first and foremost is the scale of the problem. The number of people to be moved to these new sectors and things like that. IT industry, everybody talks about 4 million jobs, nothing compared to the size of India. Absolutely nothing. Right? Not even 1%. So the scale and the size of the problem is huge. That's number one. It is then challenging in today's environment, where we have given voice to every single citizen. And I'm, not saying democracy is bad or anything like that. Yeah. So we have to discuss and debate what is the right structure for us to make this transition. You know, in industry, it's very easy, actually, honestly. Look at Dell. It was a public company, troubled times. Michael Dell came back and purchased all the shares and made the company private again. And as a private company, it's transforming itself. Okay? And he said, at some point, he will make it public again. Right? So, in a democracy, when every single citizen today has a voice because of technology and things like that, you know, every citizen today can take a video, upload it on YouTube before anybody can even see it. Millions of people can simultaneously watch it. Opinion is formed. This, you know, our minds are made. We've made some decisions based on that, actually. That's unprecedented today. So how do we make this transition? And every transition has losers and winners. So all these are challenges which we are faced with. All the things that you talked about, corruption, etc., are pieces of this puzzle. Now, we have to do all these things simultaneously, reduce corruption, increase education, increase employment, all these things simultaneously. So that is the challenge that we are faced with, and that is why, you know, if there is a possible solution, all of us should support it, rather than debate it to death till my opinion is the, you know, all of us believe that what we believe is the right opinion, right answer. Unfortunately, that's not the way we can, you know, democracy, and you know, it may be the way, but that's not the way we can actually make progress happen, unfortunately. Some people will have to sacrifice.
Archana, Purveer, and then Shetty, I think that would be the task. Yes, please.
Giving the chance. Actually, sir, you are an icon for bringing IT revolution in India, and you are starting the Center for Brain Research that also will make the wave. As you said, we can bring the result in half the price and half the time also. Besides being 30 years in this business in IT, why we do not have even a single software of our own? In all scientific, whether it is a small console or it is a big like Magic or Mafia, if each and every software is being purchased, whereas you have got the best brain with most fancy perks of our country. Please.
So it is not a challenge of smart people or capability or anything like that. Many of the software that is being used today, actually parts of it, pieces of it were developed in India by Indians or Indians abroad. So it's not about smartness. It is about how, capitalism works, the ability to take risk. Product is more riskier than services because you do the R&D upfront, you have to make the investment, and then you take a risk in bringing the product to market, spend a huge amount of money in sales and marketing, and then you may succeed. It takes many years to see the benefit. A services company from day one actually can be profitable. Infosys was profitable from day one. Risk was very minimal. That is why services really took off in India, because we didn't have access to capital. We had no risk funding available. In fact, you know, we asked for a loan and no bank was willing to give us a loan. 27 lakhs of rupees was the loan we asked for. Yeah, but now Infosys has a product also. The banking product, the Finacle product from Infosys is one of the top three banking products in the world. Many people don't know that. So on the application side, Infosys, in Indian companies have done extremely well. And in technology, Indian companies are participating. I can tell you that every single plane that you fly today, manufactured in recent times, has a piece of software from Infosys, Airbus or Boeing, or from TCS or by or Wipro. Yeah, the seat in a car, the ABS brakes in a car, all designed here in India. The Intel chip, Pentium chip, was designed in Bangalore. partly. We're contributing, but we don't own the brand. Okay, how will the brand be owned? Through acquisition. Who owns Jaguar now? Tata's. Right? So how capitalism works, we need to understand to answer that question. It is possible that Microsoft's value goes down and an Indian company buys Microsoft tomorrow. iFlex was bought by Oracle. iFlex is an Indian company, again in the banking field. So now that software belongs to Oracle and branded with Oracle.
Sir, thank you so much for your views, sir, on the digital, particularly the third revolution. We are all aware that India missed the second industrial revolution. Whilst you've articulated that the IT is contributing nearly 8% of India's GDP, $150 billion, it is going to increase. So I have a concern. We have today corporates contributing towards social causes. There is something in the defense called the offset policy. I feel India has lacked the manufacturing train. We have missed the manufacturing train, sir. We can't make an engine in our country. We can't make an aeroplane engine. Do you think, sir, time has come? And you also mentioned in your presentation that we're going to lose jobs with the digital growth. You mentioned that study of nearly 5 million jobs. Do you think, sir, digital companies, startups need to contribute towards the employment factor? That you may open a startup, but you must contribute 200 jobs. You may have a very big company. You have to contribute 1,000 jobs. If you're not able to bite that bullet, sir, I feel that we may become a $500 billion contribution to the Indian economy, but there are millions and millions of Indians who are not going to find jobs, sir. The manufacturing sector is what gives jobs to Indians, sir. Your views on that, sir?
Yeah. See, this is true for a developed country as well as a developing country. In the US, in the last 20, 30 years, disparity has increased. In fact, you saw the recent data point which said that the top 1% of people, or actually the top 69 people in the world, top 69 people in the world have more wealth than the bottom 50%. Disparity has increased, and that's why I said today the benefits are accruing to investors, innovators, and shareholders. Right? Now we need to understand this, and we need to look at the right. The solution is not to burden these people with having to create employment. Having to create employment in what? You can't be unproductive, because then you will get beaten down anyway. You will have companies that are worthless because they're burdened with this creation of jobs. What is the right answer? So we need to figure this out actually. We cannot be uncompetitive in the world and think that we can actually benefit our people. Communism was all about that. Everybody gets a job. But what happened? It's not competitive. So we need to very clearly think about these things, discuss and debate. The answer is enabling these people through education to participate. The answer is to bring about jobs that are still going to be done manually. That's, for example, palliative care. You know, so we have to figure out what are the jobs of the future, which, you know, is challenging, where we require human beings to be there and invest heavily into that. Education, I strongly believe, yes, technology can augment, but ultimately education will have to be through discussion, debate, creativity, emotions, etc., etc. That's where, you know, true education indeed happens, not just, you know, in a mechanistic way. It is by, for us to introspect, that's how knowledge creation happens, etc. So we have to think very clearly.
Thank you very much, sir. A really good lecture. I heard after a long time. Yes, sir, I have 2 points, because majority of my points are already covered in question answer session. I have a small, one question, that the so-called side effects are negative outsprings of the modern technology is widely accepted by the intelligent people or materialistic nature. That is what is growing across all persons. With the proposed new technologies, whether this is going to increase or it is going to reduce, or how to address in the beginning itself so that this so-called problem, what we have already identified, can be taken care by the future technologies. That is one.
See, I think I answered this. We cannot completely predict the benefits, the ill effects and things like that. A technology really takes off when the benefits outweigh the ill effects and things like that. And consciously we take those decisions. We take those decisions with as much discussion, debate, thought and things like that. That's all I can say. Now, you just made a statement about materialism. Even, if you go back and look at our own, ancient tests and things, we never frowned upon materialism. That's actually kind of modern, unfortunately. It's really, I need to own something. That ownership is what is, I need to get the benefit, and I do something because I want the benefit. That is what was frowned upon. Creating wealth was never frowned upon in India. So you need to understand the clear difference between that. We progress cannot be stopped and should not be stopped. Everybody should become better. I think it's very important to understand the difference, and I think Dr. Baldev or Mr. Karthian probably will be able to tell more about our ancient beliefs and things like that. We never frowned upon materialism of that way. We frowned upon belonging to me. That ownership is what was frowned upon. We are trustees of this wealth. We need to know how this wealth will be used better and for the good of humanity. In fact, we can only do that if we create the wealth in the first instance. That's very important. Thank you all very much. Really appreciate this opportunity. Wonderful questions, and the dialogue was probably more interesting than the presentation. Thank you.
We can stand up, I think. And
thank you.
May I now request Shri Kris Gopalakrishnan to give out the certificates to the participants. Shri Praveen Behere. Brigadier S.S. Bogal. Shri K.J. Daniel. Commander Purveer Das. Brigadier Umar Farooq. Commander S.K. Jha. Commandant H.H. Murray. Sri S. Muthaiya. Sri A. N. Nanda. Sri S. Narayan. Dr. Nitin Nagraj. Brigadier R.S. Patania. Sri P.V. Rajaram. Sri Prakash Reddy. Sri Reddy. Sri Pudhya Vinayagam. Dr. Chitra Rajagopal. DIG T.P. Sadanandan. Srimati Sanya. Sri Selvan. Dr. Sethi. Dr. Archana Sharma. Dr. Tarun Kurma Sharma. Sri Shobhi. Sri V. Venugopal. For coming together to make this program a success, I would like in particular to mention Mr. P. S. Aithal, our head of administration, Ms. Girija, Mr. Lalu, Mr. Arun, Mr. Ramesh, Mr. Devraju, and everybody else without whom this program could not have really worked at all. Thank you very much, all of you, once again. And Mr. Satish Bhatt, of course. All of us know him very well by now. And if I missed out any names, the fault is only mine and not anyone else's. I would also like to thank Dr. Chidambaram, who has stood by this program forever. Thank you very much, sir. I also take this opportunity to thank all of you, the main group who made this possible. Thank you very much for being such an enthusiastic and interactive group. Thank you all very much for coming to NIAS, and I hope we'll see you all again. Yes, Dr. Okay, Dr. Subhachandran has come in time. I think he went off to complete a very important task. So I may request Sri Gopalakrishnan to give him the certificate.
So, good morning, friends. I think we come to the end of a memorable week. I think we've had a plethora of speakers, excellent speakers. And I think the culmination was this talk by Sri Krishna Gopalakrishnan. This is going to be a game changer for all of us, I believe. This a course which we attended. We heard excellent speakers who have sort of, their lives are a motivational. I think they would have motivated us. Not only that, I think the kind of interaction we have had with the various participants, I think each of them coming from a different field with a wealth of experience and knowledge that has also enriched us. And I think on behalf of all the participants, we would like to thank Shri Baldev Raj and his team, the entire team which has put together this program. And we wish all the best for all such future programs and anything which each one of us can do. We are there for you. On behalf of the participants, we have a small memento for the entire NIAS team. May I request?
Though I will lead the national anthem, but I request all of us to join with me.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Banga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga उच्छल जलधि तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
थैंक यू